Hi everybody, welcome back. I'm really sorry that I haven't done any of these in a while, but I've been getting a few views on the first few that we did, so I thought I'd carry on. Now, if you followed us up to this point, you'll know that we did Matthew chapters 1 to 4, so I'm going to carry on today with Matthew chapter 5. Don't forget, if you want to join in the conversation, have a look for us on Facebook at facebook.com/Christians Together Worldwide, or just search in your Facebook bar at the top for Christians Together Worldwide and you'll find us, and you can get involved and check out some of the other cool posts we put up as well. Okay, so well, let's pray before we read then. Heavenly Father God, Lord, I just thank you for this opportunity to read from your word. I just pray that you'd share with us, that your Holy Spirit would speak to us through the reading of your word today. I just pray for those people at home watching and listening, that they would really gain something from the amazing things you speak about in this chapter. I just pray your blessing on this video and on everybody at home. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so if you're not familiar with chapter 5, this is the Sermon on the Mount. It's where Jesus gives the Beatitudes. Now, if you remember, if you haven't seen this before, I'm not a Bible scholar. I'm just a Christian who needed to do a little bit more Bible reading, so I thought I'd share with you guys. So getting right into it, reading from the New Living Translation today for a bit of a change of pace, and also because I left my NIV at work. So, starting from verse 1. One day as the crowds were gathering, Jesus went up to the mountainside with his disciples and sat down to teach them. This is what he taught them. God blesses those who realise their need for him, for the kingdom of heaven is given to them. God blesses those who mourn, for they will be comforted. God blesses those who are gentle and lowly, for the whole earth will belong to them. God blesses those who are hungry and thirsty for justice, for they will receive it in full. God blesses those who are merciful, for they will be shown mercy. God blesses those whose hearts are pure, for they will see God. God blesses those who work for peace, for they will be called the children of God. God blesses those who are persecuted because they live for God, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. God blesses you when you are mocked and persecuted and lied about because you are my followers. Be happy about it. Be very glad, for a great reward. For a great reward awaits you in heaven, and remember, the ancient prophets were persecuted too. You are the salt of the earth, but what good is salt if it's lost its flavour? Can you make it useful again? It will be thrown out and trampled underfoot as worthless. You are the light of the world, like a city on a mountain glowing in the night for all to see. Don't hide your light under a basket. Instead, put it on a stand and let it shine for all. In the same way, let your good deeds shine out for all to see, so that everyone will praise your Heavenly Father. Don't misunderstand why I have come. I did not come to abolish the law of Moses or the writings of the prophets. No, I came to fulfill them. I assure you, until heaven and earth disappear, even the smallest detail of God's law will remain until its purpose is achieved. So if you break the smallest commandment and teach others to do the same, you will be the least in the kingdom of heaven. But anyone who obeys God's laws and teaches them will be great in the kingdom of heaven. But I warn you, unless you obey God better than the teachers of religious law and the Pharisees do, you can't enter the kingdom of heaven at all. You've heard that the law of Moses says, "Do not murder." If you commit murder, you are subject to judgment. But I say, if you are angry with someone, you are subject to judgment. If you call someone an idiot, you are in danger of being brought before the high council. And if you curse someone, you are in the dangers of the fires of hell. So if you're standing before the altar in the temple, offering a sacrifice to God, and you suddenly remember that someone has something against you, leave your sacrifice beside the altar. Go and be reconciled to that person. Then come and offer your sacrifice to God. Come to terms quickly with your enemy before it's too late and you're dragged into court, handed over to an officer and thrown into jail. I assure you that you won't be free again until you've paid the last penny. You've heard that the law of Moses says, "Do not commit adultery." But I say, anyone who even looks at a woman with lust in his eye has already committed adultery with her in his heart. So if your eye, even if it's your good eye, causes you to lust, gouge it out and throw it away. It's better for you to lose one part of your body than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. And if your hand, even if it's your stronger hand, causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one part of your body than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. You've heard that the law of Moses says, a man can divorce his wife by merely giving her a letter of divorce. But I say that a man who divorces his wife, unless she has been unfaithful, causes her to commit adultery. And anyone who marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Again, you have heard that the law of Moses says, do not break your vows. You must carry out the vows you have made the Lord. But I say, don't make any vows. If you say, by heaven, it is a sacred vow because heaven is God's throne. And if you say, by the earth, it is a sacred vow because the earth is his footstool. And don't swear, by Jerusalem, for Jerusalem is the city of the great king. Don't even swear by my head, for you can't turn one hair white or black. Just say a simple, yes I will, or no I won't. Your word is enough. To strengthen your promise with a vow shows that something is wrong. You've heard that the law of Moses says, if an eye is injured, injure the eye of the person who did it. If a tooth gets knocked out, knock out the tooth of the person who did it. But I say, don't resist an evil person. If you are slapped on the right cheek, turn the other too. If you are ordered to court and your shirt is taken from you, give your coat too. If a soldier demands that you carry his gear for a mile, carry it 2 miles. Give to those who ask, and don't turn away from those who want to borrow. You have heard that the law of Moses says, love your neighbour and hate your enemy. But I say, love your enemies. Pray for those who persecute you. In that way, you will be acting as true children of your Father in heaven. For he gives his sunlight to both the evil and the good, and he sends rain on the just and on the unjust too. If you love only those who love you, what good is that? Even corrupt tax collectors do that much. If you're kind only to your friends, how are you different from anybody else? Even pagans do that. But you are to be perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect. Well, it's no surprise a lot of people struggle with that, is it? I know for myself, I like to pick and choose the nice bits. Blessed are the merciful and blessed are the meek and that sort of thing, but you know, gouge out your eye if you lust after a woman, or if you think evil about somebody, you're committing murder in your heart. And I'm not going to sit here and preach to you guys at home, because that's not really what this is about, but it's about starting to explore some of the questions that this raises. And Jesus says that not one jot or tittle of the law of Moses will pass away, and yet I don't know, there are some interesting questions there for me. First of all, we're Gentiles. Most of us watching this probably will be Gentiles and not Jews. And we were never under the Jewish law, were we? The Jewish law wasn't given to the Gentiles. So that's an interesting topic for discussion. Also, you know, we understand that Jesus was the fulfillment of the law. And in fact, he was the only person who ever did successfully managed to fulfill the law and was the only sinless person. So it kind of raises the question to me, what was Jesus doing there on the Sermon of the Mount? Was he laying down what perfection looked like? How difficult it was? Was he showing us that actually it's impossible and that we all fall short of the glory of God? Even though there is this ideal that we should aim for, and that does not mean that sin's okay or that we shouldn't really bother trying. But ultimately, you know, what happened is that Jesus laid down his life and took those punishments for us, which he's speaking about in the Sermon of the Mount. You know, that death and that condemnation and that punishment for all who don't, you know, completely fulfill that law that requires absolute perfection, he took it for us. So, I don't know, you know, in my experience, people often, you know, when you're thinking about a lot that's happening in the world at the moment and gay marriage and that sort of thing, which, oh my goodness, I'm going to open up a right can of worms there. But people are very often quoting Old Testament law, aren't they? And I've seen this on everything from BuzzFeed to George Takei's post, you know, the fact that, you know, Christians are quoting Old Testament law as a reason to be against gay marriage and a million and one other things, whereas the truth is, not only can we not fulfil Old Testament law, I don't think there's a single Christian person who tries to or really actually thinks that they're meant to. So, whilst on the one hand, that passage, that chapter there wasn't really in any way related to gay marriage, it does raise some interesting questions about who God expects us to be, especially since the law has been fulfilled. And, you know, our righteousness comes from God and our salvation comes through Jesus and Jesus only. So anyway, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, discuss. And don't forget, if you want to join in more of a Facebook kind of way, then it's Christians Together Worldwide. That's facebook.com, Christians Together Worldwide. All right, God bless you guys. See you soon.